Pacific. Book TV, every weekend on C-SPAN 2. Next, New York Senator Hillary Rodham Clinton introduces George Soros at a conference hosted by the Campaign for America's Future. This is an hour and 45 minutes.
Please take your seats quickly. We are about to begin. I'm Ellen Miller. I want to welcome you today. I'm Deputy Director of the Institute for America's Future. I am more than thrilled to kick off this second day of our conference, which in many ways is the centerpiece of our efforts to take back America. Again, let me ask you quickly to take your seats. I want to remind everyone, or tell everyone, that we are audio taping every session of the conference. So anything you say will be recorded. The staff will be passing out pieces of paper for questions, and I hope we will have time to take them this morning and certainly throughout the day. Now I want to welcome all of you who are just joining us this morning. We had a terrific afternoon yesterday with the campaign's co-directors, Bob Borsage and Roger Hickey, and we heard inspiring words and thoughts and direction from Move On's Wes Boyd and Joan Blades, from Julian Bond and Stan Greenberg, and many others. It was a terrific afternoon. And those of you who attended the gala dinner last night know what an amazing event that was. It just doesn't get any better than that. Congrats again to our award winners, Elliot Spitzer, Elaine Jones, and Move On. And many thanks to our staff who pulled off an astonishing event. I have a really big task this morning, and that's to present to you some of the most outstanding thinkers and doers in America today. Reverend James Forbes, senior minister of the Riverside Baptist Church of New York. George Soros, political thinker, philanthropist, and activist extraordinaire. And Antonia Villaraigosa, LA City Councilman and former Speaker of the California Assembly. But I also want to take a moment before we begin to briefly reflect on the extraordinary political moment that we are living in. Could it be more obvious that we are nearing the end of the conservative era of politics? And if you look at the newspapers today, it's obvious that even the media is catching on. We have a front page story in the Wall Street Journal, and it says, hopeful liberals seeing sign of political comeback. The New York Sun, the Atlanta Journal-Constitution, and others are talking about what we are doing here today and through the rest of the week. Even though I say we are nearing the end of the political, the conservative movement, I want to remind you that the right, on the one hand, has never been more powerful than it is today. It has a hold on all the major national governmental institutions, the executive branch, both houses of Congress, and increasingly the judiciary. It has mastered the modern-day money politics and built an independent message machine that is unprecedented in U.S. history. On the other hand, it is obvious that the right's ideas are bankrupt, exhausted, and failed. They have no answers to the great challenges that face us as a nation. Their policies, preemptive tax cuts, preemptive war, top-end tax cuts, environmental degradation, privatization, deregulation, and crony capitalism are increasingly understood as part of the problem, not part of the solution. As a result, an opportunity is emerging on the political horizon, and guess who's here to fill it? Yes, we progressives are poised to write the next chapter of American history. We have solutions to the immense problems facing this country. We have answers to the big questions. And we have the values, fairness, equality, justice, and democracy. Such values may seem like old ghosts at the Heritage Foundation or trite props in Tom DeLay's office, but they are firmly embraced by the vast majority of Americans. They want, as we do, a democracy that reflects the will of the people, not its largest campaign contributors. They want prosperity for our children, not a mortgaged future. Health care for all Americans, good wages for decent jobs, and a country that is truly secure. You're going to hear a lot about the progressive agenda for the next 2 days. And for the next few years, we need to make sure that we are positioned to move from the opposition to the proactive architects of a movement. A movement that not only takes back America, but one that moves it forward. Our work is cut out for us. Those who hold the reins of power will not give up without a nasty fight. And remember, they write the rules. Also, remember for us that this is not about winning or losing the next election, though we know how we'd like that to come out. We're here to build a movement. So win or lose in November, that's our job. This is not an impossible task. In fact, it may be inevitable. As Bill Moyers told us last year, progressives are on the right side of history. America's many blessings are as a result of concrete progressive victories. As he said, our role is to keep the blood pumping through the veins of democracy. There's much more to be said about that, and much more will be said. Now, though, I want to turn to someone who can say it far better than I, Reverend James Forbes, Senior Minister of the Riverside Church of New York. Reverend Forbes grew up in the Pentecostal movement and is ordained in the American Baptist Churches and the original United Holy Church of America. For the past 15 years, he has been the senior minister of New York's historic Riverside Church, where he leads a large interdenominational, interracial, and international congregation. The Riverside Church is a place where the people of New York are used to their preachers speaking truth to power. Newsweek magazine recognized Reverend Forbes as one of the 12 most effective preachers in the English-speaking world. He has earned 3 degrees and has been awarded 13 honorary degrees. He is one of the most eloquent and articulate voices challenging what is happening in the country today. Reverend Forbes believes that poverty is a weapon of mass destruction. In a recent sermon, he asked, "What is God thinking about in these times of war? What does he think about the widening gap between the haves and the have-nots? What is God thinking about the drift away from parity, equality, and justice?" And then Reverend Forbes answered his own question. He said, "God's heart aches, and it is a sin to be silent." Please welcome Reverend Forbes.
Well, brothers and sisters, I need to take time to express my gratitude to Ellen Miller, not only for her introduction, but for discerning the central issues that I'm concerned about these days, and to express gratitude to you for all you've done in regards to public campaigning. You're on the case, and I'm on your team. Thank you so very much. Now, this is early for a preacher. My time is 11 o'clock. So I need to get myself ready for what I'm called upon to do at this particular moment. And that is, I need to have my own devotions. And it's the devotions I've been involved in ever since 9/11 in a very special way. It won't take long, but it will at least get me centered in regards to the things I wish to share with you today. I usually wake up and pray a prayer like this: Holy Spirit, lead me, guide me as I move throughout the day. May your prompting deep inside me show me what to do and say. In the power of your presence, strength and courage will increase. In the wisdom of your guidance is the path that leads to peace. And then after I get through with that prayer, I can then go on and take my shower. But I have been usually singing in the shower. It is not my expertise, but you'll have to forgive. This is what I say. Because the days have not been beautiful when considering the drift in our nation, a drift away from the spiritual and the moral and the democratic ideals upon which the nation has been built. Particularly since 9/11, we seem to be giving various reactions to post-traumatic stress disorder, and our thinking and policies are disordered in very significant ways. So in order to get up and get going, I sing the shower song. It says, I'm going to take heart and get moving, though the clouds hang heavy and gray. If I wait for blue-skied perfection, I'll be waiting till judgment day. Why let myself be held hostage, trapped and blocked by who knows what? Will standing still in sinking sand reverse my fate? Certainly not. I'm going to break out and risk living, though the reasons to wait still abound. I will do what I can in the climate of now till better days roll around. So take heart, my sisters and brothers, give your spirit a holiday. Away with the reasons, delaying the season. Celebration is the order of the day. I really mean it. Celebration is the order of the day. And then... After that, I'm usually ready to get out on the trail. Now, let me tell you what is to be celebrated. I am so happy to be here in the company of the committed, committed to working, sacrificing, struggling for the day when America can say, I'm back. Now, let me explain that. Many of you have experienced seasons when you knew you weren't quite what you thought you were. Sometimes it has to do with physical or emotional and sometimes spiritual destabilization, or if we were going to tell the truth about it, there are seasons of depression where eight-cylinder cars seem only beaten on three or four, where we are not able to experience the exhilaration even from the good work we do. And after a prolonged period where you don't feel like you, the you of you, is actually home, to be able to wait and to delay and to pray and to just seek help, and then one day you experience that well, heavenly day, I'm back. I am now sensing the old me, but with a new vitality. Now, I'd like to think that America has been through some seasons like that, when in regards to the founding values upon which this great nation was built, America has not felt at home a lot lately, with the widening gap between the rich and the poor, with the new spirit of dominionism taking over in the name of God. America doesn't quite feel the same. The redevelopment of class preference and the ignoring of the poor, or the kind of abandonment of the spirit of tolerance and inclusiveness, a growing spirit that serves the few and abandons the common good. America has not quite been feeling like herself or itself, if the feminist critique would require me not to always use her in her negativity, using she. So I say to you that I believe we ought to celebrate, because those of us who are in here, we just long for the time when America can say, listen up, citizens, I'm back, and that's why I celebrate today. I am here as a religious leader, and I am especially grateful that somebody found me, showed me the newspaper from the Times, but even before I got to that one, there was the USA at the door, as usual, and it even has an article about the place of religion. Normally, to come here, one might be urged to mute the religious dynamic as a way of being respected in a group of progressives. In fact, there are polls that increasingly tell us that those of us in here have probably not been to church in a long time. Now, I know that's not true for all of us. I have to go. I get paid. But today, I do not apologize. I come representing religious leaders who believe that given the nature of the pseudo-religion or the genuine religion that still lacks sanctification of substance, that given the present administrative direction and the claims that are made, even those who are not interested in whatever they consider to be the downside of acknowledging the religious dimension, I think we're going to have to do it. So the real question is, how can we, in this time, acknowledge that whether you are atheist or agnostic, if you are involved in a progressive cause and you want to see success, not only, as has been mentioned by Ellen, not only in November, but in the days ahead, given the head start of a completely different understanding, somehow we need to do something significant. First of all, as a preacher, on behalf of the highest powers, I want to assign to you this responsibility. Do not allow the religious right to determine whether you are religious or not. There are other options. I understand this. I was growing up as a kid in a Pentecostal church where the nature of my piety did not seem to conform to the expectation. And part of my psychological problematics in life grew up about being in a community that dared to question my authenticity and my integrity because I did not bear the same signs of religious experience that they did. By the way, I finally did. It's all about speaking in tongues. I was always troubled about that because I tended to put my mind in gear before I put my mouth in motion. But nevertheless, I learned that is the most dangerous thing in the world. Let somebody else tell you that just because you don't go to church as often as they do, just because you do not use the same language they use, just because you do not have the same kind of dedication to certain people as they have, that you therefore are a second-class citizen in the sight of God. Let me tell you, I have learned, even from the reading of the Gospels, that Jesus sometimes hung out with folks that were considered the last to be to enter into heaven. Why? Because there was something real about them. They didn't pray as much, maybe. They did not have as much pietistic language, but they did something about the prayers they prayed. And I want to ask you, look, you don't have to go every Sunday. Of course, I'd be happy to have the churches filled with the likes of you. Maybe it would deepen our commitment and translate our piety into deeds that are done rather than just rhetoric. But I'm here today to say what I'm praying for. What I am praying for and why I'm glad to be here is because together, religious and progressive leaders can help speed the day when America can say, I'm back. Now, when I speak about being back, I have in mind something of when America was truly itself or herself, if you'll permit. It's a combination of things. America, a city set on a hill, a nation with the light of liberty in its heart, in its mind, and in its soul. A place where liberty and justice are so loved so deeply that one declared in Virginia, "Give me liberty or give me death." A land of high ideals where everything is possible if it's necessary for democracy to keep its promise. A people whose dreams are bold and people who struggle valiantly to make their dreams come true for themselves and for others. A Declaration of Independence, the Constitution, the Bill of Rights, pulsing with the vitality of democratic strivings and thrivings. I'm talking about a nation like that. Now, America was never all that she was supposed to be, because America is not only what it is, but it's always what it is becoming. It acknowledges its flaws because it could never settle for containment within mere pretense. And the citizens of America have been able to wave old glory and be proud because of its integrity and its power to inspire creativity and productivity. But I say America is not quite herself itself these days. For many of the citizens of our land, those in the hinterland and those near and around the capital and 1600 Pennsylvania, have lost confidence in the founding principles upon which this nation was built. There are many who are allowing themselves to be hopelessly divided between the red and the blue. And that also includes between races and class. There are those who have lost a sense of mission and who think that the primary existence of America is simply to fight terrorists. There are those who are now in a matter of what I call prostituted patriotism. Prostitution. Prostitution, I call it, when you have a relationship with somebody, even have meaningful, passionate relationships, but you don't know them, you don't care about them, and you are not willing the best for them because you are in it for what you can get out of it yourself. That's what I call prostituted patriotism. Well, America is not quite what she has been. Then there are those who, using the same image, prostitute government. Use her when it's beneficial for what your special interests are, and the rest of your time you're talking about how irrelevant it is, the smaller the better, not being able to enjoy any benefits therefrom, prostitution. Well, I'm here to say we don't need to spend too much time talking about who led her away or how she drifted away, but the truth is, let's say, America is not quite herself, given the virus of hate that's spreading through the land, given the triumph of greed, given the pride that sometimes reaches supremacist dimensions, nationalism, imperialism, dominionism, rugged individualism that cares only about itself, privatism, consumerism, all of these others. Somebody has led to the abandonment of the true American ideals. Now I'm here today as a preacher who's concerned about the society. I preach on Sunday, but I talk to you today about why America must come back. If there is such a thing as national purpose or manifest destiny, it's not just a social compact or a social contract. There is a calling from the source of our being as a nation. And you can call it what you want to. Many religions call it God or Allah. But I'm saying that whatever the source of the great ideal of America, that source could be disappointed if America does not turn around from the direction it's headed in. And secondly, why America must come back. We are too powerful to be unprincipled. May I say that again? We are too powerful. One of my friends in Brooklyn said, "Compassion without power is futile, but power without compassion is fatal."
And it certainly is. In an age of globalization, we can finally understand the wisdom of the Native American who led Tom Perry to write these words. This we know, all things are connected, like the blood which unites one family. Whatever befalls the earth befalls the sons and daughters of the earth. Man did not weave the web of life. Man is merely a strand in it. Whatever he does to the web, he does to himself. Let me say to you, America needs to come back. There are reasons why. The world needs something, some form of the value and the spirit of moral and democratic commitment to the common good. Religious communities know that America has been a laboratory for the grand experiment showing that people can live together in peace. We have gathered them from all over. The lady in the harbor invited them. And we were on the verge of demonstrating in this age of globalization that we can live together, that Rodney King's question is not out of order. And yet, since 9/11, we've been acting like we are so scared we've abandoned the experiment. We're like PhD candidates that get to the end of their research and never write the dissertation. America, it's time to write the dissertation and share it around the world. Well, how can we find the way back? I want to suggest, let us remember those who inspired us to be at our best, our founding mothers and fathers. Let us look again at the founding documents and help citizens across the country to see that therein is the DNA of America. And anybody who acts in a way that thumbs a nose at the Constitution, at the Declaration of Independence, at the Bill of Rights, that you have had a strange shift in your DNA, a genetic mutation making something real odd, and that's what's happening in America, a shift in the DNA. For those founding documents tell us who we are really supposed to be. And brothers and sisters, I challenge you, why not join with those of us of a progressive religious understanding? And some of us have instituted what we call canine theology, canine as in dog. What we mean is when you see the house on fire, you are a dog in the house. There may be somebody else who claims to be an owner, but clearly a loving dog would at least go up and lick the master. And if that doesn't do, bark, keep barking. And if that doesn't do, pull the covers off. Do you get my drift? We need to be like dogged, determined to make America what it ought to be. I believe that America, which is such a great nation, and Lord knows I love America, but I tell you, I am afraid that if we don't get some things done here, we're going to be in real trouble. My time is up. I'll be talking. My church has sent me out on the road. And furthermore, we're trying to get more progressive media. Every time we see something from the right-wing madness, there ought to be a progressive voice that stands up and speaks against it. Well, one of the things I'm doing is I'm going around, and this is a plumb line. Somehow, the religious community will hold the plumb line out of the traditions, not just Christians, but Protestants, Catholics, Jews, Muslims. We will try to discern from our faith tradition what are the values that will make for a great nation, and where has the nation strayed away? And if we can figure that out, then we will be able to have the rest of you with your extraordinary expertise to help rebuild America in a manner of which we can all be proud. Well, I tell you how excited I am. They are telling me my time is up, but I will not close until I tell you what happened to me in 97. I was at Harvard at the Du Bois Center, and A. Leon Higginbotham, the late A. Leon Higginbotham, told us there at that place that the last time he was in Nigeria, he saw a sign which ought to be a message to the people in America. He said, there's so much erosion of the values of this nation, that if something happens and we go away for 5 years and come back, we may not even recognize her for what she is. I think he was right. Then he says, this is what the sign said. The sign said, no time for foolishness. Will you repeat that after me? No time for foolishness. Now, actually, those words go with this rap, and that's what I'm closing with now. I'm closing up. But I want you to help me when I get to the right place. You just say, no time for foolishness. And may that be our watchword until November of 2004 and of 2005 and of 2006, until we are ready to say America's back. Here's the rap. Listen, it goes something like this. Look. Airplanes falling, peace talks stalling. Listen, there are those folks who are crying to make it right, backstabbing, throat grabbing, kids getting high on drugs and glue, short graves, long graves, you never know which, electrocuting men just to see them twitch. Now, I don't mean to be uncouth. All I'm asking for is tell me the truth. What time is it, y'all? You know the answer. No time for foolishness. Affirmative action, under attack, you bring your money home, there's a hole in the sack, spousal system, parental abuse, sometimes you wonder what's the use, AIDS keeps spreading like an eating cancer, nations call for help, but there is no answer. Now, I don't mean to be uncouth, all I'm asking for is tell me the truth, what time is it, y'all? Races and religions all self-contained. High blood pressure from too much strain. Why are our families falling apart? We went searching for pleasure and we lost our heart. Hope and love are in short supply. America's got to find a purpose or else we'll die. Now, I don't mean to be uncouth. All I'm asking for is tell me the truth. What time is it, y'all? That's right.
I think you may see a few more people in church next Sunday. Imagine what he's like at 11 o'clock in the morning. And now we have a very special treat to introduce George Soros, Senator Hillary Clinton. America's future, but you're helping to make the kind of future that we need and deserve to have. I have known Reverend Forbes for 25 years. I've never seen him so filled with the spirit and energy that we saw this morning, and it's because he does have a prophetic vision, and he does understand what made this country great, and he realizes that we must take our country back in November through the electoral process on behalf of our democracy. You know, when I first got to the United States Senate about 3.5 years ago and saw that the Bush administration wanted to undo everything that the Clinton administration had done, I admit, I took that kind of personally. But then I realized it wasn't personal at all. They wanted to undo all the way back to Franklin Roosevelt, all the way back to Teddy Roosevelt. They were heading to the robber barons of the late 19th century, and everything we've seen since proves it. You know, in a time like this, it is not only those of us in elected office who must speak out and stand up. It is even more important that citizens do that. We have an opportunity in the next months to put together not just a winning campaign, but a movement. An opportunity that I believe is being seized every single day throughout our nation by individuals who say, I've had enough. Who understand that four more years of the Bush administration would leave our country unrecognizable. Those of us who love America, who believe with all our hearts that we are part of making it a more perfect union, that we are called upon to not only love our country, but to love our fellow Americans, and to set an example of moral leadership around the world for the kind of nation that we want to be. And so you're here filling this ballroom, and there are countless Americans like you who have never been involved in politics before, who for the first time are saying, yes, I will. I was on Long Island a few weeks ago, and a very well-dressed, obviously affluent woman said to me, Senator, I'm 48 years old. I have never voted before. I said, why is that? She said, I don't know. She said, I was just always so busy with everything going on in my life. I never thought politics made a difference to me, and so I just never went to the trouble. I've had so many other people, young to old, tell me that it's the first time ever that they have been activated, motivated to follow politics, because they know we're at a great decision point. And I hope that through meetings like this, through the coverage of the media, we are reaching millions of Americans who may never have thought of themselves as political, but who are understanding that the decisions made from the White House to the Congress to the State House are turning America backwards, undermining hard-fought victories on behalf of civil rights and civil liberties, on behalf of economic opportunity and justice. So our job is not just to come to an event like this and to cheer great speakers like Reverend Forbes, but to leave here and talk to our friends and our neighbors, the people we work with, the people we know in our communities, to persuade them also to understand what is at stake. Now, among the many people who have stood up and said, I cannot sit idly by and watch this happen to the country I love, is George Soros. And I have known George Soros for a long time now. And I first came across his work in the former Soviet Union, in Eastern Europe, when I was privileged to travel there, both on my own and with my husband on behalf of our country. And I saw the awakening that was occurring as people who had been oppressed, who had been turned into automatons, were all of a sudden saying, well, what about my future? How will I choose to live? And George Soros was there, from Russia to Slovakia, all through the region, willing to invest his own resources, to open universities, to set up all kinds of civic organizations, to give people a chance to do what we take for granted in this country, to associate, to speak out, to be part of something greater than ourselves. And I saw the results on the ground in those countries. Now George Soros is using his considerable success in our free market, in our democracy, to make sure that his opinions are heard in the marketplace of ideas. That is within the great American tradition. Now, you're going to hear, if you haven't already, many, many attacks on George Soros. They are coming over the transom. They are being carried on the media. And you know, we have two kinds of media left, it seems to me. We've got the so-called mainstream media, which is on the one hand this and on the other hand that. And then we've got the advocacy media that is turning more into propaganda than information.
And so you will see a steady drumbeat about what right does this very successful man have to use his resources to try to create political movement and action. Well, I'll tell you, he has the same right as all the people on the right have had for the last 50 years to set up the structures that they have invested in. You know, I do know a little bit about the vast right-wing conspiracy. Oh, and there were doubters. But you know, that didn't happen by accident. It happened because people with a very particular point of view. They didn't like labor unions, they didn't like civil rights, they didn't like women's rights, they didn't like health and safety protections, they didn't like environmental protections, they didn't like energy that would make us independent from being totally dependent on the Gulf, on and on and on. They came together literally starting 50 years ago. They created think tanks, they invested in endowed professorships, they set up other media outlets, on and on and on. And there were a handful in the beginning of people who didn't like the direction of the country starting with the New Deal. You know, they just didn't think that was much of a deal for them. They kind of liked the powerful being able to lord it over the powerless. And so they very slowly but surely tried to change American politics, and you've got to give them credit. They've done a good job. They got themselves a president and a vice president and lots of other people who marched to their drum beat. It's not in the tradition of American values or ideals. In fact, one of my favorite lines, especially in this year as we celebrate the incredible accomplishments of Brown versus Board of Education, which sparked a civil rights movement, thank goodness, in our nation, is that the organization that the White House lets vet and recommend judges for the federal court, called the Federalist Society, they have members who go around talking about bringing the Constitution back from exile because they believe it went into exile with Brown v. Board of Education. Because declaring that children deserved not separate but equal, which could never be separate and equal, but instead needed equality in education, was considered somehow a detour from the Constitution being used to protect property rights and establishment rights and values. So don't ever let anyone tell you that what we're part of this year to take back America and to set up institutions and structures to compete with those that are deeply embedded in the life of this town and have so much to do with the decisions that have been made for more than a decade, that somehow we're the ones who are illegitimate. My goodness, I believe in democracy. Therefore, I believe in speaking out and fighting back. And we cannot do that if we don't have people literally from one end of the country to the other, and if we don't have people like George Soros who's willing to use his resources to help us organize. But we cannot leave it to the George Soroses of the world. No matter how much he helps, no matter how much he contributes, he is one person. And we have to do our part to make sure that we are a multitude of voices, and that the activism and involvement of our citizenry leading up to this election is unprecedented. Then, of course, we have to make sure that the votes are counted. You know, some of you know that I've joined with Congressman Rush Holt and Senator Bob Graham to introduce legislation to have a verified paper ballot to go along with the direct election by computers. And, you know, there are lots of problems with the equipment and with the security, and we just need to get it worked out. But isn't it a little embarrassing that India just voted 550 million people using electronic voting, didn't have one problem, and changed the government in a political earthquake. Now, they are the largest democracy in the world. We are the oldest democracy in the world. I certainly hope that we have an election that is as free of complaint and concern as that one just was. But that is also going to take organization and commitment from thousands and thousands of Americans. We need people to be not just registering voters and getting people out to vote, but to be poll workers, to be poll watchers, to be involved in their local communities as these decisions are made. You know, as much as I care about who wins this election, I care more that we run an election with integrity. Because for goodness sakes, we have to prove that we can do that. And I know that this is a nonpartisan group. But I will just close with this. All the work that we're doing, the work that all of you, groups like this, George Soros, countless others, it is not just for this election. It is for the long term. We are still a long way from the promise of America being fulfilled. We have come further than any place in human history. But with all due respect to my friends in this administration and on the other side of the aisle, it was not rich people like George Soros who made America great. It was average, working Americans who believed that tomorrow could be better than today. It was people who got up every single morning and did the best they could for their children, who built businesses, who taught in schools, who led churches, who created communities. It truly was a dream that we were given as our birthright. For those of us born here and for others, it became part of who they were when they came here. That is what is at risk in this election. Yes, I can give you a critique on every single issue, every single policy of this administration. But at the end of the day, it is their stubborn refusal to recognize the debt we owe to the future that bothers me the most. They, on every single issue that matters, are, and I'll use a term that Mr. Soros would understand, they're shorting the future. They are undermining our capacity to control our destiny. They are short-circuiting the dreams of people who need to believe that not only is America special, but that we do have a role in the world that is irreplaceable. So this election, yes, it's about candidates. And I am as committed to electing John Kerry president as I have ever been involved in any election in my entire life, because I believe he would be a great president, a serious, thoughtful president for a difficult and challenging time. But electing leaders is only part of the equation. We once again have to become better citizens. You know, it is not enough for America's future that some participate and others don't. It is not enough for America's future, the future we want to see for our great country, that it seems like our highest goal in life is to be consumers. We have been given an extraordinary blessing, and at this moment in time, our country needs us, and we need people like George Soros, who is fearless and willing to step up when it counts. So please join me in welcoming George Soros.
I'm very, very proud to be introduced by Hillary. I've seen her in operation. I have great, great admiration for her. I see her deliver a speech in Davos about open society that explained the ideas better than anybody else that I've heard. I've seen her visit Central Asia, where I have foundations, and she was really very effective, more effective than most of our statesmen in propagating democracy, freedom, and open society. And I think she hit the nail on the head when she said that there are people who have never been involved in a very active way in electoral politics who now feel the need to do so. And I stand here before you as such a person. I have a deep commitment to the principles of democracy and open society, but I have been, I felt that I best devote my energies to other parts of the world. And it is the first time that I feel that I need to stand up and do something really and become really engaged in the electoral process in this country. In my foundations, basically, I have provided financial support for people in those countries who believed in the idea of an open society. And I think Hillary again said the right thing, that it isn't one person with money that can make a difference. It can only make a difference if there are people in the country who believe in those ideas and willing to stand up for them. That is what The reason I feel that I had to get engaged is because I don't think this is a normal election. This is a referendum on the Bush administration's policies, the Bush doctrine, and its application, its first application, which was the invasion of Iraq. The Bush doctrine, people don't actually talk about it very much as a doctrine, but it really is quite an atrocious proposition. It's built on two pillars. One, that the United States must maintain its absolute military superiority in every part of the world. And second, that the United States has the right for preemptive action. Now, both these propositions, taken on their own, are quite valid propositions. But if you put them together, they establish two kinds of sovereignty in the world. One, where the sovereignty of the United States, which is inviolate, not subject to any international constraints, and the rest of the world, which is subject to the Bush doctrine. It is, to me, it is reminiscent to the George Orwell's Animal Farm, that all all animals are equal, but some animals are more equal than others. Now, President Bush was not elected on the basis of... Well, you are applauding because you're saying that he was not elected at all. But he was elected by one vote in the Supreme Court. So he is our president. But he was not standing on the Bush doctrine. He didn't propagate the Bush doctrine. He was presenting himself as a compassionate conservative who was advocating a humble foreign policy. Now, then came September 11. He declared war on terrorism, and that was when he declared the Bush doctrine. So, the coming elections are, in effect, a referendum on the Bush doctrine. And if we endorse that doctrine, then we have to take the consequences, the mistrust and rage that is directed against the United States today. If we reject it, then the blame belongs where it really should be, namely in the policies of the Bush administration. And we have to show that America doesn't stand for those policies. So let me maybe give you a little bit of background, how I came to feel that this is now the most important issue that I'm engaged in. I was born in Hungary. I'm Jewish, and when I was 14 years old, the country was occupied by the Nazis, and I would have been killed if my father hadn't taken the precaution or had the foresight to provide false identity for his family. That year, 1944, was a formative experience in my life. Then we survived the Holocaust, and the country was occupied by the Soviet Army. And I think that my life would have been wasted if I hadn't taken the precaution of leaving the country and coming to this country. And this is the country that I believe in and I stand for. So I experienced at a very early age how important it is, what kind of social system prevails. And when I left Hungary, I went to England, London School of Economics, and I studied, and I was very much influenced by the philosophy of Karl Popper, who wrote a book, Open Society and Its Enemies. And he explained that there is something similar, a common ground between fascism and communism. And that is that they believe that they have access to the ultimate truth. And that is impossible, and they want to impose that, their view of the world. Now, nobody has access to the ultimate truth, and therefore, if you believe in it, you have to impose it by force and repression. He said that this leads to a form of closed society, and he proposed an alternative, which is the recognition that we all base our decisions on imperfect understanding, and different people have different views, different interests, and we need institutions that allow them to live together in peace, and that is open society, democracy, and that is the United States is a prime example of an open society. Popper was a philosopher of science, and he showed that even science cannot reach the ultimate truth because we are participants, and what we think is part of what we think about. So that because of that, we can't establish the truth of a statement which says that the statements correspond to the facts. Now, I developed that idea into a concept of reflexivity, that there is a two-way interaction between your perception of the world and reality, because your perception is part of reality. And I use that, tested it in the financial markets, and I was rather successful. The theory actually works better than the prevailing theory, which is that markets are perfect and they provide you with the best optimal allocation of resources, and markets tend towards equilibrium. I don't believe they do. They always go to one extreme or another. And that's how financial markets behave. You have booms and busts. And I was, with this theory, I was rather good in exploiting that. Now, when I made enough money, or when my fund reached $100 million, I thought that's enough money. And I really reflected on what I want to use the money that I'm making for. And that's when I established a foundation devoted to fostering the concept and principles of an open society. That was in 1979, and my first involvement was in South Africa, where you had an apartheid regime, which really needed to be broken open. And then I got involved in my native country, Hungary, and the neighboring countries, and eventually established a network of foundations covering mainly the countries which were coming out of the Soviet regime. And there I made the discovery that the collapse of a closed system doesn't automatically lead to an open society, that you need to give a helping hand, because open society is more complex than a closed society, and you can't get there without some help from the outside. And as I said, basically I provided support for people in the country who were trying to build open societies, and the foundations did make some valuable work. Then, basically, the revolution ran its course, and I became involved with the problems of globalization and the inequities, the imperfections of our global world order. And then came the election of President Bush, and the September 11, the response, the way President Bush responded to it by declaring war on terrorism and fighting it by military means, and the Bush doctrine and the decision to go to war in Iran, in Iraq. Now, when President Bush was elected, as I say, he came with a humble foreign policy, but there was an ideology that was basically a pretense, because behind the election platform, there was an ideology And I describe it as an ideology of a crude form of social Darwinism, namely that life is a fight for survival, and the survival of the fittest depends on competition and not cooperation. And that is where I think the ideology is false, because yes, we need to cooperate, and it's not, competition is by itself is not enough. Now, this philosophy expresses itself in the economy, in the belief that you should rely only on the markets for the allocation of resources. Now, I'm not opposed to markets. I'm a creature of markets, and I fully appreciate the great benefits they bring, but they can only serve the allocation of resources among private needs, and there are public needs which require cooperation, and markets are not designed to provide public goods, only private goods. And that is the distortion in our globalization. I'll come back to that. In this fight for survival of the fittest in international relations expressed itself in what is called geopolitical realism. Kissinger saying that states have interests but no principles, and it's the interests of the state that determine international relations. Now, this idea was then taken to an extreme by a group of people who are in the Bush administration. They're usually described as neoconservatives, but I think that may not be the appropriate description. I call them American supremacists. They say, that international relations are relations of power. The United States is the most powerful, and therefore it must use this power to impose its will on the world. Now, there's an element of truth there, because America, in fact, is the most powerful nation on earth, but the concept of power, particularly expressed in terms of military power, is a false concept. Altogether, this the idea of power is borrowed from natural science, and it doesn't work very well in social science. I think that power is much more complex, and I think the right definition of power is in the children's game, stone, scissor, and paper. And we now see, actually, an example. Stone is, let's say, military power. It is supposed to be able to crush everything. And paper, let's say, is public opinion. And paper can lift the stone. And we see that happening in Iraq. So this idea of military power is a false idea, and the idea that we can impose our will on the world is really just the wrong idea. Now, we went to war in Iraq on false pretenses. There was no connection between Saddam Hussein and Al Qaeda. There were no weapons of mass destruction. But what I find the most galling is the pretense that is now presented that we went to war in Iraq for the sake of the Iraqi people. If we had done so, we would have sent in more troops, and we would have protected not only the Ministry of Oil, but also the other ministries and the museums and the hospitals. Since I am, you know, I've devoted the last 15 years of my life in helping to introduce democracy and open society in various countries, I can speak from, you know, personal experience that using military power to bring democracy is absolutely not, it's a quaint idea. So this led me to write a book called The Bubble of American Supremacy, and also to put my money where my mouth is. Now, in my book, The Bubble of American Supremacy, I actually applied the theory that I developed, the boom-bust theory that I developed for the financial markets, to the Bush administration's policies. And let me just explain very briefly. See, bubbles don't come out of thin air. They always have a basis, a solid basis in reality. But there is a false ideology or a misconception that is applied to that reality. And that is what carries then reality into what I call far from equilibrium territory. You could see it in the stock market with the internet and technology boom, which was very real. Internet is a very real thing. But it was misunderstood, which actually led to its development, went faster, but then it was became unsustainable and collapsed. So you have originally self-reinforcing and then self-correcting process. That's a boom-bust. And this is, in fact, what applies to the Bush administration's performance, because you have a reality, an underlying reality, that is that the United States is the most powerful nation on Earth. But then you had this ideology of this crude social Darwinism applied to it, which is a false idea. And it was that the terrorist attacks of September 11 that moved you from, let's say, what you might call near equilibrium to far from equilibrium conditions, because it was the war on terror and the attack on Iraq that took us into this very, very, very dangerous area that you are. That we are in now. Now, a boom-bust process is usually tested. And if it is tested and it survives the test, then it is reinforced because it looks like it's working. But eventually, perceptions move too far away from reality and become unsustainable. There is a moment of truth when the falsehood of the prevailing misconception becomes apparent, and then there is a reversal, and then that becomes self-reinforcing, and you have the bust. Now, in my book, I argued that Iraq was this test, and it is, in fact, the moment of truth when we realize that we've been deceived and we have embarked on a policy that cannot possibly succeed. And I think that the reason that we were carried so far away from equilibrium is because the president, by declaring war on terrorism, basically stifled criticism, because to criticize his policies were to be unpatriotic. He said that, you know, those who are not with us are giving support to the terrorists. Ashcroft passed the Patriot Act, saying that those who oppose the act are giving aid and comfort to the terrorists. So for about 18 months, the critical process, which is so essential to a democracy, was stifled. And it is only when things started going wrong in Iraq that it was reopened. And I think that the picture of torture in the Abu Ghraib, in Saddam's prison, was the moment of truth for us, because this is not what this nation stands for. I think that those pictures hit us the same way as the terrorist attack itself, not quite with the same force, because the terrorist attack, we were the victims. In the pictures, we were the perpetrators. Others were the victims, but there is, I'm afraid, a direct connection between those two events, because the way President Bush conducted the war on terror converted us from victims into perpetrators. This is a very tough thing to say, but the fact is that the war on terror, as conducted by this administration, has claimed more innocent victims than the original attack itself. So I think that the American public has now seen that they've been misled, and they have turned against the Bush administration, and I think that we are now well on the way of the bust. Now it's not plain sailing, because just as the self-reinforcing part underwent test, the self-defeating part also is going to be tested, and I think that the Bush administration does have a plan to disengage from Iraq. It is being implemented, and the objective is to reduce the number of body bags. And for that purpose, the administration is willing to abandon all its other objectives,
both those that it, that were publicly announced and those that were the real motives in order to achieve this. And it's actually a very cleverly perceived plan, because by transferring sovereignty on on June 30th and holding elections in January, and withdrawing the troops, disengaging the troops, it is possible that the number of attacks will in fact diminish. Now, this withdrawal means that the various factions can maintain and develop their militias. We have allowed them to survive both in the Sunni area and in the Shia area. The Kurds already have their army, the Peshmerga. So it sets up for effectively civil war after the elections. It's very much like Bosnia, where you had three ethnic groups, each with their own militias, going into elections, and then going into civil war. Now, it's very important to realize that the Iraqi involvement has been an utter disaster for the United States. Even in terms of the American supremacists who wanted to demonstrate America's military power, actually our military power has diminished. Our ability to project military force has been diminished because our army was not trained for occupation. It was trained to bring overwhelming power to bear. And the fact that we are now bogged down in Iraq reduces our military might. And of course, the damage that it has done to our standing in the world hardly needs to be explained. I wanted to go into an alternative vision for America's role, because I personally am convinced that there will be a change of regime in this country. I think the general public now recognizes that they've been misled, we will reject the Bush doctrine, but we need an alternative vision. We need an alternative vision to reestablish our position in the world. And let me just say very briefly what that vision is. We are the leading power in the world. That puts on, we are the most successful dominant economic power also. And that imposes on us a unique obligation to lead the world in improving the present world order, to correct the deficiencies of globalization, because we can't impose our will on the world. We can't do just whatever we want. But there can be no cooperative effort without our participation and leadership. So we must change our attitude and recognize the need to work together and to correct the deficiencies, to improve our arrangements for security, how to deal with the likes of Saddam is the great unresolved problem of our world order. And the way we went about it makes it more difficult to deal with that problem. We must change that approach, but we must help to develop better methods of intervening when it is necessary. We mustn't turn away from the world because we are increasingly interdependent, and what happens, what kind of regime prevails in Iraq or Afghanistan does have a great bearing on our security and on our prosperity. So we must develop ways of intervening when there is a repressive regime or a rogue state or a failed state. But we must do it. We cannot do it alone. We must do it in cooperation with others. Thank you.
I'm sorry we didn't have time for questions for Mr. Soros. I'm sure there would have been a lot, but perhaps next time. I want to thank him again for so generously giving of his time, joining us for the dinner last evening, and for this morning's session. Thank you. I'd like to continue by introducing the introducer to our next speaker. The next speaker will be Antonia Villaraigosa, and here to introduce him is Harold Meyerson. Harold is a Washington Post columnist, editor-at-large for the American Prospect, and the man who knows more about California politics than any other human being. Harold, and we're here.
By the way, after Mr. Soros' remarks, I just want to call to all of your attention. I don't know if you noticed in the morning papers, there was a little story about Trent Lott going on effusively and praiseworthy about what went on in the Abu Ghraib prison. Trent, who was sort of the Bubba of American supremacy, Trent has been responding positively to Abu Ghraib ever since the pictures came out with all those hooded hats that went up there covering people over. As Ellen noted, besides my various gigs here as a journalist in Washington, I am still, though I moved here 3 years ago, the political editor of the LA Weekly in Los Angeles, because there are certain places in the United States where the America's future and the progressive future is really being tried out. And I would remind you that Louis Brandeis spoke of cities and states as laboratories of democracy. And he was right. I mean, the New Deal didn't spring totally out of the heads of Franklin Roosevelt's brain trust. Much of it developed and had been tried out in Al Smith and Franklin Roosevelt's and Sidney Hillman and Fiorello LaGuardia's New York and in Bob La Follette's Wisconsin. Those were the work sites of 20th century liberalism, and we need today to be able to identify the work sites of 21st century liberalism. And improbably enough, I say improbably because I grew up in Los Angeles, lived there most of my life. It was, you know, the hometown of Richard Nixon and Ronald Reagan, but boy, that town has changed. Over my lifespan, the whitest large American city has become the least white. A city that was sort of the epicenter of the post-World War II American dream of the majority middle class became preponderantly a city of rich and poor, and a city whose fathers had conceived it as sort of the non-union Protestant alternative to that iniquitous city to the north, San Francisco, has become really a democratic bastion with pioneering living wage ordinances and with probably the most militant, politically potent labor movement of any city in the country. The key to that transformation has been the political mobilization of the city's massive Latino immigrant community. And when you walk through those neighborhoods, the working class communities of the East Side, the San Gabriel Valley, the San Fernando Valley, it's not hard to discover who the political hero in those neighborhoods is. Antonia Villaraigosa grew up in some of the roughest streets and housing projects in those communities. From his mid-teens, he's been an organizer par excellence. I think Antonio set up the Black Student Union at his almost all Latino high school. An organizer of immigrant workers, of unions, of the Civil Liberties Union. He was elected to the California State Assembly in 1994, and in a few short years, he became speaker. And there he authored really massive bond measures that have provided hundreds, I think by now thousands, of schools and parks across the state, including especially to inner city neighborhoods which hadn't had them. In the year 2001, he waged a campaign for mayor in Los Angeles that galvanized virtually all of progressive Los Angeles and then some with his detailed vision of bringing more opportunity and justice to this two-tier city, galvanizing young people in the city all across lines of race, building the kind of model progressive coalition that we need in order to prevail. Now, that coalition turned out to be just a little bit too small to actually put him in the mayor's office, but there's an election next year. He's looking at that office today from the vantage point of the city council seat that he now holds and from which occasionally he functions as a de facto mayor in things like brokering a transit strike and such. I was in Antonio's council office in LA just last month, and he noted, this was totally off the record, but therefore I'll share it here. He noted that he'd never really aspired to be the official lanceman for any ethnic group. That's a Spanish language term, lanceman. But for those of us here who believe in economic justice and democracy and in a non-imperial America that's a land of opportunity, Antonio is our lanceman, he's my homie, and I'm happy to welcome here to this conference, Antonio Villaraigosa.
My lanceman. Good morning, everyone. Good morning. We're here today to take our country back. We're here today because we believe that America can do better. We're here today because while some would say America, love it or leave it, we say America, I love you and I want you to be all that you held yourself out to be. I'm the son of an immigrant. On my father's side, my father came in the 1950s from Mexico. He came as millions of Mexicans and others from every corner of the earth have come to Los Angeles. I oftentimes say that when you think about Los Angeles in many ways, Los Angeles is to the world what New York was in the 20th century and London in the 19th. We know that because when people come to America, their Ellis Island today is no longer New York in the numbers that it used to be. It's LA. And they come and they come and they come. And they come here because there is opportunity on a scale and scope second to none. We know that what makes this country different is that in this country, we've had a strong middle class. I was in Mexico not so long ago with then Governor Gray Davis. We were sitting at the home of a billionaire, a man by the name of Carlos Slim. And they asked me, so for an American of Mexican descent, in a nutshell, what's the difference between the United States and Mexico? And I said, oh, that's simple. If my people had stayed here, I'd be serving you right now. Instead, they came to America, and now you're having a dinner in my honor. My father came to this country precisely because here you could work hard, play by the rules, and be a part of that American dream. Today, when you opened up the newspaper, USA Today, I don't read it very often, except when I'm on an all-night flight like I was last night and didn't have anything to do before I got here. But there was an article about the gap, the values gap, and the gap between those who go to church regularly and those who don't, and their support for Republicans if they go to church regularly, and their lack of support for Democrats. And one of the things that was so glaring to me is that we're missing an opportunity. Because those of us who are here today, who have been involved in the civil rights movement, the movement against the war, the progressive movement, the environmental movement, the women's movement, we make up the majority of America. We have values. Yes, we do. Our values are no different. We raise our children to be honest. We raise our children to fight racism. We raise our children to struggle for equality. We raise our children to treat the other and embrace them. These are great values. These are American values, these are human values, and these are values that we should be proud of. So make no mistake about it. No party, no group in America has a monopoly on values. We believe, for instance, that health care is a right, not a privilege. That the only issue should be, how do we get there? We can debate on the head of a pin all the things that make us different and all the strategies of how to get to health care. But at the end of the day, our value is that every child in America, every working family, every mother and child, every grandparent should be able to go to a doctor and have health care because that's a right. We're here today. We're here today because we believe that we can build a movement around those values, a movement that says that in a world where we have said for so long, in a nation of laws, in a nation founded on the principle of the rule of law, that we can't break international law to go to war in the way that we have. That a country that respects the rule of law doesn't just respect it in this country, but promotes it throughout the world. We believe that it's important for America not to be divided into Americas. One of the reasons that I was asked to speak today is not only because I'm a board member of this organization, but I imagine part of it, but also because I hail from that shining city, the one that I told you that's the magnet for immigrants from all over the world. You know Los Angeles. It's a city of incredible wealth. It's a city where we have more millionaires than any other city, with the possible exception of New York, and on a per capita basis, certainly more than New York. It's a city where in many ways that dream gets played out on a scale and scope second to none. But let me share with you the other LA. The United Way, not an organization that is, you know, considered progressive by any stretch of the imagination, did a study, The Tale of Two Cities, it was called. And what they talked about was that LA is the homeless capital of America. That LA is the capital of America for the uninsured. That LA, that shining, great, wealthy city, is the city with less home ownership than any big city in the country. that LA has more children without health care than any big city in the country. And the list goes on and on. We believe that Los Angeles, New York, Chicago, the rural Appalachia, that we could do better than that. And so we've come together. We've come together to put an agenda for another America. An America where we don't leave the immigrants behind. An America where we honor work and say that when you work and you play by the rules, you should be able to buy a home at the end of the rainbow. An America that says that healthcare is the right, not a privilege. An America that invests in those that we have left behind and bridges the gap. An America that says that race still matters in America, and we've got to confront the issues of race and the legacy of slavery. That we can't forget that America was built on a legacy of slavery. We are here today because we want to reconnect with that movement that started so many years ago, the movement against the war, the movement for civil rights, the movement for the environment. We want to connect them. We want to build organization and begin to articulate a new vision. This is not, by the way, a partisan agenda. We want to welcome everyone under our tent. We want to welcome those evangelical Christians. We want to welcome the rich, the poor, the middle class, because we believe that these values and this agenda is an agenda that can excite people, is an agenda that can inspire people, that America can do better, that America is a special place, but only when we continue to honor the values and the principles that made America strong. And so we come today to this conference, and we don't come just to hear speeches. We come to connect. We come to build a movement. We come to begin to have that debate here in the country, not just in this election. This election is important. Make no mistake about it. But this new America will not be won or lost just in this election. We've got to build an infrastructure that goes beyond elections and organizes more people to vote, more people to engage, more people to make a difference. And so I want to thank all of you for being here today, because I know that your being here today sends a strong message to cities all across the country that we can build a movement around core principles and values, that we will not allow the right wing to wrap themselves around the flag and take our America from us. That we are better than that. Many have said that the generation who fought in World War II was America's greatest generation because they fought the war against fascism, because they built an America built on the model that all of us should be lifted up. I believe that this is a great generation as well, and that we are going to take this country back and say to the right wing that America has to be a place where all of us are included, that America has to be a place where we honor those who work, where we build and grow together and not leave some of us behind. I want to thank you for having me here today. I want to thank you for coming today. I want to excite you about going back to your communities and build that new America. Thank you so much. Thank you. I understand a couple of questions. We're out of questions. Good. Thank you so much. Love you all. We'll see ya.
Sunday on Road to the White House. C-SPAN talks with Democratic presidential candidate John Kerry. That's at 6:30 and 9:30 p.m. Eastern and Pacific.
C-SPAN follows the candidates along the campaign trail. Watch our 2004 vote coverage throughout the week, including the conventions and candidate tours shaping the election, and Sunday evenings on Road to the White House at 6:30 p.m. Eastern. Later in June, watch coverage of the Green Party convention live, the 2004 presidential campaign on C-SPAN, the political network of record.
Find out more about the 2004 presidential campaign at cspan.org. Click on 2004 Vote for candidate profiles and positions and the Campaign Finance Database. Watch the latest video of campaign events and campaign ads for each candidate. Keep track of the campaign with detailed calendars. Complete 2004 vote information and more at cspan.org.
More now from the conference hosted by the Campaign for America's Future. Remarks by former presidential candidate Howard Dean. This is about 20 minutes.
Okay, folks. I'm glad you liked that nice little video reel. Thanks to Adam Luna and Harry Hanbury for putting it all together, and all of the groups that put those ads, the creativity, and the money behind them on the air. I have a hunch that a lot of people in this room were supporters of Howard Dean. You're going to hear from Howard Dean in a minute, and the Campaign for America's Future is going to give him our Tom Paine Award for leadership. And to introduce all this, I want to bring on a real friend of the Campaign for America's Future, a real friend of every progressive in this room, a U.S. senator who has been a progressive champion since his campaign to get to the U.S. Senate, a candidate and a senator who we could always turn to on the big issues, the important issues, to champion them not only in the U.S. Senate, but around the country. Someone who speaks with a certain amount of credibility about the U.S. economy, and somebody who is working day and night right now through the Democratic Senate Campaign Committee to take back the U.S. Senate. I give you Senator Jon Corzine.
Thank you. Move forward over there. Hi, folks. Where do you buy stock and moveon.org? We gotta go. Welcome to all of you who wanna take back America. I do too. We're gonna do it. Right now, this year and today, we're in that process. And I can't begin to tell you how exciting it is to be here with all of you. We couldn't be meeting under better circumstances with regard to this Campaign for America's Future. People are fired up and we're ready to go. We could be not meeting under better circumstances for my party and your party, I hope, the Democratic Party, the Democratic wing of the Democratic Party. And we couldn't be meeting under better circumstances, in all fairness, to take back the presidency, the United States Senate, and I even think we can take back the House of Representatives. We put our shoulder to the earth on. For myself, my kids, my grandkids, your kids and grandkids, I thank you all for your passion and caring about these issues. This is where it's at. And we also owe a great debt of gratitude to Bob and Roger and Ellen and all the people at Campaign for America's Future, because they're making a difference for all of us. I want you to know I'm a proud progressive, and I'm going to tell you this. I'm a proud liberal that believes an America dream belongs to everyone. I was here last night, so I kind of picked up on the party line. It belongs to everyone, not just Buddy, not just for George and friends, but for every American, young and old, rich and poor, black, brown, and white, Muslim, Christian, or Jew. It belongs to all of us. You've heard from many and most of the most responsible leading this debate about making America everything it should be, making it that open society that we've all dreamed about, that we're proud of. And I'm proud of them for all of the fight. You've had a great, great group of people here. But no one deserves more commendation and respect with regard to that debate without his effort, without all of his work. The direction of America would not be in challenge today the way it is. And that's the person I will get a chance to introduce to you, Howard Dean. Before I present him,
a little less conversation, a little more action. All this aggravation ain't satisfaction in me. A little more bite, a little less spark. A little less fight, a little more spark. Close your mouth and open up your heart and maybe satisfy me. Satisfy me, baby. Baby, close your eyes and listen to the music. Dig to the summer breeze. It's a groovy night and I can show you how to use it. To come along with me and put your mind at ease. Hey! A little less conversation, a little more action. All this aggravation ain't satisfaction in me. A little more bite, a little less bark. A little less fight, a little more spark. Set your mouth and open up your heart. And baby, satisfy me. Satisfy me, baby. Come on, baby, I'm tired of talking. Grab your coat and let's start walking. Come on, come on. Come on, come on. Come on, come on. Don't procrastinate, don't articulate. Girl, it's getting late. You just sit and wait around.
If I could have your attention for about 2 minutes. I know you want to hear from me when the star is here. But we have one little task that I want to talk to all of you about. Something that's on the top of my agenda, I hope it's right at the top of yours, and that's taking back the United States Senate. I hope you believe in your hearts it's something that can be done. Let me just tell you, if we all went to the polls on Tuesday next, it would be 52-48. I know the numbers, and they're there, and we can make it happen. We got to make it happen 150 days from today. Why? Because America knows, as Howard Dean taught us, that we are on the wrong track. We have to change direction in America, and we can make it happen if you all put your shoulder to it. And unfortunately, and this is the part that I want to make sure you understand, unfortunately, fortunately, it doesn't really matter, many of the most important races, the brake races that will make a difference in taking back the Senate, aren't necessarily in those places where we're going to have the most competitive battleground states for the presidency. Alaska, Oklahoma, maybe Colorado will be in play, Illinois, South Carolina, North Carolina. We need to win these seats. We're going to win these seats, right? We got to make sure they happen. And beside your financial aid, we need to make sure that all the passion that's in this room and all the organizational skills, whether it's labor or the issues that you fight for day in and day out, are put to work to make sure in all of these places we make sure Democrats are elected. Call the DSCC, call up our website at www.dscc.org, and you'll find out about it. We can make it happen if you help us make it happen. Now let me return to introducing an American hero, somebody that is a hero for all of us, Howard Dean. Governor Dean is a man who reshaped American politics. Remarkable outreach tactics. I think you got a few friends here, Howard. Tell the true strategy and revolutionized American politics. We know it, and we are grateful. We could not be more proud of this individual. He has given us hope, and he has given us inspiration. He's a man of courage and conviction. He's a man who truly changed the world as we know it, and we are proud of him. And as Bob Cutner so ably wrote, Governor Dean gave a new generation of young people hope in this country's institutions. He's fundamentally transformed the way we do politics, and he's re-energized the Democratic Party. How true that is. He's demonstrated there was a real hunger for a candidate who could speak truth to power. Truth to power is how we will win this election. Howard Dean's American hero. We're proud of him. Let me now present Howard Dean.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
First of all, thank you. Let me just say one thing. I appreciate all the kind words, but the truth is that this was our campaign, not my campaign, and it is not over until we win back the White House and send George Bush back to Crawford, Texas with that one-way bus ticket. And the way... You know, one of the things I always really liked about campaigning was it is really fun to listen to the audience. You know, there was a lot of stuff that we did in our campaign that other people are now starting to do. And one of the things, including the Republicans, which is not so good, but one of the things I learned to do was to listen to what the audience said as I was speaking. And somebody over here just touted the president's favorite program. This person over here really likes the president's new initiative in going to Mars, and we agree the president should definitely go to Mars. That's better than a one-way bus ticket to Crawford, Texas. I think he's going to need some help, so we'll send John Ashcroft along with him. And I understand, as of today, we already did send Gene Tenet there, and that's just one down. It's about time somebody in this administration resigned over all the misdeeds that have gone on, and let this not be the first one, culminating on November 2nd when George Bush is the last one to fall. Dick Cheney, Richard Pearl, Paul Wolfowitz, Donald Rumsfeld, not one of them told the truth. We can do better than that. How about that email that Dick Cheney sent over to the Army Corps of Engineers about Halliburton? You think that had anything to do with putting a little money in Halliburton's pocket? And did you know that Dick Cheney's getting money from Halliburton directly on his deferred compensation? How about a GAO investigation of that if you want to worry about corruption at the highest office of the land? How about all that wealth transfer? You know, the Republicans used to be against wealth transfer, but they don't mind now that it's coming from working people into the pockets of people who run the largest corporations in America. How about what this president has done for the environment? How about that? The Clear Skies Initiative, which allows us to put 500% more mercury emissions into the air. We can do better than that, and John Kerry will do better than that when he's the president of the United States. You know what's going to win this election? Two things. The first is that people have to decide that George Bush ought not to be president anymore. I think they're well on their way to deciding that, because They question whether the president has told the truth, and people will not elect a president who they don't believe is telling the truth. Secondly, it's the economy. Think how many Americans are struggling with increased property taxes because the president passed No Child Left Behind, which is an unfunded mandate on local school boards. Think how many Americans are struggling with increased health insurance premiums, driven up even more because the president cut 1.5 million Americans, including 500,000 children, off health insurance. They get their care from somebody, and it ends up, gets shifted to the insurance companies and shifted to us. Think about all the Americans that are struggling to try to figure out how in the world their kids are going to pay for college education. There was a study in the New York Times not very long ago that showed the percentage of parents with kids in the best schools who make over $200,000 a year skyrocketing, and the percentage of parents who make less than $50,000 with kids who are able to afford college is going down. Why do you think that is? I think it has something to do with the fact that the President of the United States cut 84,000 kids off their Pell Grants so that he could make sure that Ken Lay and the boys who financed his first campaign had a little more money to put in their pocket. That's our money, and we're going to take that back along with the country. I'm going to do everything I can to get John Kerry elected President of the United States. And I understand there's some policy differences between some of you and Senator Kerry, but let me ask you this. If you were worrying about the defense of the United States of America, who would you rather have in the White House? A guy who, like so many people, send our children to war, never served a day in his life overseas, or somebody who's been to war with 3 Purple Hearts and a Silver Star? I'd rather send a combat veteran to the White House so they won't send our kids to war without telling us the truth. Who would you rather trust protecting the environment? The guy with a 0 rating from the League of Conservation Voters, or a guy who stood up for renewable energy even when it wasn't popular in Congress, even when it cut some donations from important Democratic funders? I'd prefer John Kerry. That's who I'm voting for. Who do you think's going to do the most for working people in this country? A guy who never has, or a guy who has? I'm voting for John Kerry. This election will not be over on November 2nd, no matter what happens. I saw an extraordinary presentation this morning, which some of you have seen, by a fellow by the name of Rob Stein, who has tracked what the Republicans have done since 1964 in order to get power in this country, in order to control all 3 branches of government, the Supreme Court, Congress, and the White House. And with Fox News, maybe even the 4th branch of government, who knows? We know what the right wing has done, and we're going to have to do it. Will Rogers once said, "I don't belong to any organized party, I'm a Democrat." Well, you know, we used to laugh about that. It's not very funny when we now see what the consequences are. As you know, we've started a new group called Democracy for America, and since I have a captive audience of 2,000 of the most vigorous activists in the entire country on the progressive side, go to our website, democracyforamerica.com. We have what our intention is to do is not just to support John Kerry, which of course we're doing, or as Jon Corzine was talking about, to support candidates for the House and Senate. We're going to do some other things that aren't being done, and we need to coordinate this and figure out how to do it over the next 10 years, not over the next 5 months. And that is, we need to build our grassroots. You know, I'm always fond of saying that it's George Bush's a long litany of things that are wrong with this country, and I think most Americans agree, but there are 2 other parties that have something to do with this. One is the Democratic Party for not standing up to George Bush and his right-wing extremists when they needed to do it. And now they are. And now they are. And the other is us. 50% of us don't vote. 50% of us thought somebody else was going to do the job. You know, all of us who have been in public office, and I know there's some out here that are, have been fond of saying, going to high schools and going to colleges and telling young people how important it is to vote. Well, one of the things I learned in this campaign is voting is the bare minimum. Voting is not enough. You've got to give 10 bucks to your favorite candidate, and we, Lord knows, we showed that you can sure raise a hell of a lot of money by getting 10 bucks from a half a million people. And you've got to run for office yourself. You have to run yourself. Democracy is not a spectator sport, and we won't have one if we don't fight for it. So over the next few months, we're going to partner with 21st Century Democrats, with the Progressive Majority, with SEIU, with AFSCME, with other groups where we can come together not just to make sure John Kerry is the next president of the United States, but to make sure that if he is, that this is not simply a way station in between right-wing presidents, that we are going to take this country back this time, and never again are we going to permit the extreme right wing of the Republican Party to tell us what to do. I am tired of listening to the fundamentalist preachers, and we're not going to do it anymore. I'm tired of listening to Ralph Reed and Newt Gingrich and Rush Limbaugh, and we're not going to do it anymore, because we built this country, and we're going to take it back for ordinary working Americans. We're going to take this country back, and it's going to take election after election after election, work after work after work, and win after win after win. Take back America. We want our country back, and it's our country. We built it, and now, in November, we're going to take it back. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Governor Dean, on behalf of the Campaign for America's Future, to present to you our first ever Tom Paine Common Sense Award. Thomas Paine, the patriot, the pamphleteer, the man who spoke truth to the powerful, is an inspiring figure for all of us. Paine had an enormous and devoted following. It grew to huge proportions when he learned to make use of a powerful technology. In his case, it was the printing press. He used that power to foment a revolutionary movement. Could anyone more aptly be called on as we honor Governor Dean? Listen to Tom Paine. He said, "These are the times that try men's souls. The summer soldier and the sunshine patriot will, in this crisis, shrink from the service of his country. But he who stands now deserves the love and thanks of man and woman." Governor Dean is no sunshine patriot. He got us all to believe that we, it, as Tom Paine said, have it in our power to begin the world all over again. For this, we are forever in his debt. Thank you, Governor Dean, for re-energizing us to take back America.
Sunday on Road to the White House, C-SPAN talks with Democratic presidential candidate John Kerry. That's at 6:30 and 9:30 p.m. Eastern and Pacific.